Mr. Thorpe, we have heard from the Prime Minister and from Mr. Heath on the post-election state of the nation. How do the Liberals regard the situation?
Well, the Prime Minister appealed for national unity, and our position is no different from what it was after the February election, that we think the job of a responsible opposition is to support anything that is relevant and in the national interest. And indeed, I offered both Mr. Heath and Mr. Wilson after the last election, when either or both could have become a minority government, one in fact did, that we were prepared to have talks to see if an agreed package could be reached. Now, in the present situation, I think obviously we want to see how they will tackle inflation. The social contract, I think, means as much or as little as you want. We want to see what's going to happen for liquidity in industry and what they'll do about prices. But so long as they govern in the national interest, we shall behave as a thoroughly responsible opposition.
Do you accept what appears to be the Labour Party view, that the opposition parties are too fragmented and diverse in their views to provide an effective opposition?
Well, I think that remains to be seen. I certainly don't think so as far as the Liberal Party is concerned. I think, however much we may be criticised, we certainly took a tougher line on inflation and the need for a statutory prices and incomes policy through an inflation tax than anybody else. And I mean, whether it was The Sun or The Guardian or The Daily Mail or The Guardian or The Times, they all said that we had a clear and definable policy on inflation. Whether one agrees with it is another matter. But certainly we have a coherent view, and we shall see that it's heard.
Lord Helsham, Mr. Heath appeared to be laying down a number of conditions, barring the acceptance of which there could be no national unity with this government, such as no nationalisation. Are the Conservatives in any condition to lay down conditions?
Well, I'm not sure that you're right in your supposition. As I see it, I saw both broadcasts. I haven't spoken to either of the broadcasters. But the need for national unity is the same as ever it was. And the crisis is as grave as ever it was. But as I understood the small print of the Prime Minister's broadcast, he was going to carry out or seek to carry out his entire programme, which of course he's entitled to do on the basis of his party majority. But he can't carry out the controversial items of his programme without criticism and opposition from the opposition parties. There can be no national unity based on a controversial party political programme. There can only be the ordinary operation of party politics.
There surely has to be opposition unity, doesn't there, though, to provide effective opposition?
Not at all. I think we put forward our own points of view, but I rather fancy that on some of the more controversial items, the views of the opposition will not be disunited, but we put forward, at least I assume the members of the House of Commons will put forward the points of view for which they were elected. And those of us who are in the Conservative Party will oppose nationalisation, will oppose the destruction of private medicine and private or grammar school education. But on the other hand, and incidentally, we must oppose, I expect, although I'm speaking only for myself, a reflationary budget when the principal enemy is inflation. But obviously one examines the proposals of the government if and when they're put forward, and the first opportunity will be the Queen's speech.
Do you expect that Queen's speech, Mr. Short, to run into difficulties from the start?
No, I don't think so. I think it'll be a very reasonable Queen's speech, based on our manifesto, of course. We fought the election on a programme, I think one of the best programmes we've ever had, which is completely relevant to the needs of the late 1970s and to the economic crisis facing the country, and we shall start in this session to carry out the programme.
But
what Lord Helsham is saying is that they'll support us so long as we adopt conservative policies. What he means by controversial policy is one he doesn't agree with.
Well, obviously you can't expect us to oppose support policies we don't agree with.
There will be opposition.
If they bring a Queen's speech, Mr. Thorpe, that includes most of the things in their manifesto, can you possibly support them?
Oh, certainly not. There are things we shall oppose. And I don't actually think the Prime Minister was saying we hope everyone will support everything that is said in the Labour manifesto, which after all only received the support of less than two-fifths of the whole electorate. No, I think what he was saying, and the spirit in which I would wish to interpret it, is that we are going to have a very tough winter, whatever government got back, and there may well have to be some very unpleasant, tough things that are done. And provided the low-paid and the people who would be hardest hit by inflation are looked after, then I think that we may all have to work together to get some very unpopular things done. Now, I think that is what we've got to be prepared to deal with during the winter months. There is an appalling liquidity crisis in industry at the moment. 3,000 million has been taken out in tax, 900 million of it in advanced corporation tax. We never before had to pay our tax before we've actually incurred it. I think the Chancellor may even have to operate and do something before the budget. So I think the Queen's speech will merely be an indication of what the government proposed to do. It will be the specific measures which are introduced that we will look at. But if, as I say, the mere fact that they are unpleasant and unpopular doesn't mean to say they will be opposed if they are in the national interest.
Lord Helsham, are you happy that the Conservative Party goes into this united enough at the present moment? Would you like to see an end to wrangling?
Well, it's the business of every party to settle its own domestic affairs without much help from the other parties and without too much interference. I hope that we shall be able to achieve this in due course.
If I may say so, that was a masterly statement.
Thank you, Jeremy.
Belonging to a small trade union of three, I wholeheartedly approve of.
Thank you, Jeremy.
Right. If they bring in, as Mr. Short indicates, Lord Helsham, a policy, a Queen's speech which sticks closely to the manifesto, there is no way, surely, that there can be this national unity that they're talking
about.
Oh,
you're putting it much too harshly, really. You see, nobody expects, and least of all the Labour Party, that they should bring their whole manifesto forward in the first session. It was designed, like all manifestos, you must be fair to them, I'm not often fair to them, but I propose to be fair to them on this occasion. The manifestos, like all other manifestos, is intended to cover 5 years of legislative activity. The question is what they put in first, and what they do, quite apart from the things they ask for in their legislative programme. If they put forward the kind of programme I expect, I don't think there will be national unity, but I shan't commit myself, nor I expect that my colleagues could commit themselves in advance to opposing something. If they approach the thing in the spirit of national unity, by which I mean not that they should adopt a Conservative policy, with due respect for Edward Short, he's quite incapable of anything so good, but if they really make that criterion, what is needed to deal with the economic crisis as it exists.
But that's precisely what they say that they are doing, isn't it, Mr. Short?
Well, I think they're not doing that, but I will have to see when it comes. It's not fair to ask.
Well, is the manifesto just for 5 years, or will a lot of people in the Labour Party not want a great deal of it implemented right at the start?
It's a manifesto for 5 years, as Quinton has said, of course, and we intend to stay in office for, you know, some years, the full period, and we shall propose a fifth of that in this year's Queen's speech. But I imagine there's a great deal in the Queen's speech with which both Quinton and Jeremy would agree. And I very much hope that we shall have their support, especially on the measures in the budget to deal with the extremely serious situation.
I'm interested to hear that you say you intend to stay in office for some years, for 5 years even. May we rest assured we are not going to have another election in the near future or in the next year?
I think you can assume that pretty safely. But you know, I was chief whip in '64 when we had a similar majority of three, and we survived for 18 months then without being defeated. And I'm quite sure the present opposition parties, there's much less unity among them than there was at that time. So I think I don't anticipate any great difficulty in staying in office.
Mr. Thorpe, in the last 30 seconds or so, problem in the coming months and years, if Mr. Short is right, is surely going to be to retain the Liberal image, isn't it?
Yes, it is. But I think whatever people may say at the last election, people knew what our policies were. And after all, more than half as many as voted for Quinton's party supported them. I think there were 5.5 million people who knew what they were doing, and they obviously we've got to keep.
Well, may you not get lost in the general battles of the House of Commons.
It's always a risk. It's our job to see that we're not.
Mr. Thorpe, gentlemen, thank you all very much indeed.
Thank you.